Hello and welcome back to All Things Money. I'm your host, David Blaine. Thank you for joining us today. We're having an interesting discussion about some long-term investing principles. If you missed the first segment, head on over to the web, dlblaine.com, and there you'll find an archive of the show in a week or so. Okay, back to what we were talking about. This first principle was to don't forget history, look at history, study history of markets and investing, and that will help you keep that long-term perspective. Number two was that we don't want you to borrow money to invest. Unleveraged portfolios can't be what we call stopped out. Leveraged portfolios can. And so the biggest danger of borrowing to invest is it reduces the investor's ability to wait things out. If you have borrowed money and you have to make payments or you have a margin account at a brokerage firm and the markets go against you, it can become very difficult to wait it out because you have this overhang of debt. I would say the same thing about these leveraged ETFs. Although you're not directly borrowing money to invest in them, they are. And so they're leveraging somehow through options or futures your money. And once again, the daily moves in those things are so large that it really inhibits an investor's ability to be patient with it. So we don't want you to use debt. Even in the real estate market, a lot of people found out that even in the real estate market that over-financing properties can be a bad thing. You know, in the heyday, 2005 or so, people were borrowing, 100, 120% of the property because it was going up at 15, 20% a year. Well, they found out in a hurry that debt cuts both ways, and over-leverage can be the end of a disaster. I was having a conversation with somebody the other day, and there's a widow that we were recently working with. We had mostly worked with the husband before, and he was in all sorts of high-risk investments before he became our client. You know, some land development, waterfront property, all sorts of things. And quite a few of these, frankly, went to zero. They were pretty much worthless. And he had borrowed, and so he had debt on basically worthless assets. And so his wife, poor wife, thought that's what investing was. She really had no experience. And her sole focus, we were talking about risk and reward and all these sort of things, and she thought investing was the type of thing where you either made a lot of money or you lost everything. And so it made me realize that sometimes we have to step back and talk, in simple terms. And that is one of the things, when you don't use leverage and you use broadly diversified types of investments, the likelihood of you losing your money, the permanent loss of capital, is virtually nil. If you go out and leverage or use exotic options, I say exotic options, or you invest in individual companies, there is a chance that you lose all your money. I mean, even a blue chip like Bank of America, several years ago, who would have thought that Bank of America would be trading, in the single digits or low teens for an extended period of time? Not many people. So anyway, don't use leverage. It can exacerbate any loss, and it inhibits your ability to be patient. Number three goes without saying, everything we do, don't put all your eggs in one basket. Don't put all your treasure in one boat. Whatever you want to say, don't count on one investment. Sure, the Bill Gates of the world, the people that have concentrated their money and concentrated their focus tend to reap the greatest rewards. But that's not investing. That's building a company. That's going out on a daily basis and building a company or something like that. That's different than investing. We're talking about investing is taking excess capital that you have earned from your labor, converting it into investment assets. That's different than focusing your investment. Or even if you own a business and you focus your investments in that business, that's different. What we're talking about is an individual investor that is trying to grow their assets for some point in the future. Do not put all your focus on one thing. Diversify. It helps give your portfolio that resilience and that ability to withstand shock. The more different they are, the better. And it enables you to survive those critical periods of downturn. So if you have a, you know, five U.S. large mutual funds, and I see this all the time. People come in from a brokerage firm. They got all these American funds. They got 12 American funds. And they're all basically invested in the same thing. That's not what we're talking about. You know, five U.S. large funds, four U.S. mid-cap funds, and two small funds is not diversified. Diversification is stocks, bonds, you know, inflation-protected securities, real assets such as real estate, you know, commodities, foreign stocks, emerging stocks, U.S. stocks, different types of equities. That's what we mean by diversification. It is hard to do. A lot of investments tend to move. I forgot gold. Gold has provided good diversification over the years. But it is difficult to do. It's not easy. But the point of this is that having 10 mutual funds in your portfolio does not mean you're diversified. You've got to see how those investments react to different stimulus in the economy. If they all move the same direction, then you have no diversification. The next principle we want to talk about, which kind of underlies everything we talk about, is being patient and focusing on the long term. So when we come back from the break, we'll pick up with that, continuing with our timeless principles investing. So for All Things Money, I'm your host, David Blaine. We will be right back after a few short messages.